I'm going to explain, like, through the conflict in literature meme, I'm going to kind of explain what, like, what the classical, what the modern, what the postmodern is. And this goes beyond art, because, like, this is expressions of our reality and our way of being. And, like, this means a lot for these, like, when it comes to film, especially as we progress through and go move forward into the future. So, like classical themes, you have like man versus nature, like, you know, the man, like human being against the wolves, against the monsters that exist in the deepest, darkest parts of the woods, that kind of
thing. Like Beowulf.
Yeah, you have a lot of unknown, exactly. And then you have man versus man, like, you know, you have wars, warriors fighting, like fighting honorable fights against each other, like of the struggle of one man to like triumph over the other. And then the third theme that is kind of like in all, like that runs through classical art is man versus God, the struggle that that small finite creatures such as ourselves have against the vast, powerful, infinite, and that's often like very unknowable and very mysterious to us. It can also be like very punishing as well, like just like the conflict that we experience with that. And then within like the next stage we kind of get into is modern art, basically, in the modern era. Like I said earlier, like modern era starts a little bit earlier than people realize, but once you like you get kind of get into enlightenment and past that, you start to see other themes begin to emerge. And this isn't just like a conscious choice that people make, like, oh, I'm going to be a classical person, oh, I'm going to be a modern person. Like, this is like this is your day-to-day reality that you're living through. This is the way that you perceive the world. And as technology develops and as knowledge increases, this completely changes the way that you perceive reality and the world. Is how, why you end up with, like, for example, when we get to postmodernism, why you have the hyper-reality problem. But so the themes of modernism, you have man versus society, because now things are becoming more complex, societies are becoming larger, and what is our place within that society? We've moved beyond nature because we've tamed nature, and now it's man versus society, and social problems begin to much more emerge. Then you have man versus self, because now that you're not having as many physical conflicts between people on a day-to-day level, like it becomes more of like this, like especially as you now, you know, live in a society, you have man struggling with himself. What does the self mean, especially with self?
George Costanza, Seinfeld.
And then this is because of the Enlightenment. This is the period where people begin to very, very much question the idea if there even is a God. And it's man versus no God. What does it mean to be alone in this cold and uncaring universe? Like, what is the struggles of that? So, unfortunately, you then enter into the third territory, which is the reality we're in. I would argue we're kind of like in an uneven one, where like there are people that are basically have a modernist reality while everyone else is beginning to move into a postmodernist reality. There's like a lot of it's staggered, like we're kind of in a staggered situation right now. But so with the postmodern themes, what you have is that you have man versus technology. Like, you can, if you read Jacques Ellul, you'll get you'll understand what he, like a lot of the stuff where he talks about what he calls technique, which is basically how, because technology has developed so much, it basically exists to perpetuate itself, like where now everything is like we don't shape technology. Technology shapes us. Technology has become so overpowering that it's no longer man versus nature. It's no longer man versus society. It's man versus technology, because the technology is creating itself and it's shaping us. It's stronger than anything. Like, it's grown beyond our control.
You know, I've thought about that recently too, about the way that technology has basically provided us with a lot more free time than our ancestors had, but we tend to get that time monopolized by technology itself. We just stay locked into continuing to use the technology. This is very striking if you live in an area that has a lot of natural beauty, because you find yourself wondering, like, why are these people not going outside? Like, they have all the free time in the world. They've had all these labor-saving devices and these like work from home job situations that afford them the opportunity to go outside into nature, but they would rather watch Netflix.
And I mean, I have to really make it clear on this, is that technology isn't shaped to us. We are shaped to technology. You live your day-to-day life going from various points to use different technology, and your life is dictated by different technology. Technology is every aspect of your life now, and your habits and decisions and the places that you live and the way those places are are designed, are all shaped by the necessity of technology. Like the way that cities are structured are designed to make sure like that you have traffic lights and the like. Everything is shaped around technology.
It's not a human space or natural space. You're in high speed corridors that take you from one island of technology to the next island of technology, and there's no escape from it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then so the next so we in classical, just to kind of reiterate, because I know like I'm kind of going on long about this, but this is worth going over. Like you have classical, man versus man. Modern, you have man versus self. And then in postmodern, it's man versus reality, because this goes hand in hand with the technology thing. Because again, like you are not shaping technology. Technology is shaping you. And once you get to the point where like your understanding of the world has so fundamentally shifted and so many other things can actually have control of it, like what your sense of reality is under constant siege. And this goes like this gets into things like with psychology, because like everyone's basically just psychologically messed up now. Like people do not have healthy perceptions of the world and reality anymore because of this complexity that they're forced into, that as human beings, like we were never designed for this level of complexity. We weren't designed, we didn't evolve like slowly into this complexity, like with especially with the Industrial Revolution, we were hijacked into this complexity almost overnight. And the human mind is just not equipped to deal with that reality. And then what ends up happening is because we're able to hit all those pleasure points like, in our brains, like we can fine-tune everything to get very specific chemical reactions. Like it ends up being like where we create these situations like through media, again, which we're completely saturated with, where the things that we see on screens are much more appealing to us than in real life, and it ends up being more real than real. That's what this word hyperreality is bandied around a lot. That's what hyperreality is. Hyperreality is that it's when it's more real than real. When the blood that's on TV, like when you see blood in real life and doesn't look real to you because the blood on TV that you saw is much more real to you and you have a much more stronger mental and emotional connection to that. That's your perception of reality. And when you go outside your door and you actually see like a dead body for the first time in your life, you don't know how to process that because like that's not the dead bodies you've seen before. And you've seen thousands of them when you've, you know, when you're watching whatever drama it is that you're into. Like how can this be real? I've seen thousands of dead bodies. I don't know what this is. And then the last theme is which gets into this. When man versus God gives way to man versus no God. And we're now in a place where we don't even know if we ourselves exist anymore. It's man versus author. And that's where it gets into like the metafiction aspects of that, because we are so untethered from any sense of reality. We're so deterritorialized, deracinated, depersonalized, de-everything, that we are basically at the point where we only consider ourselves to be characters in media, even if we are living and breathing creatures ourselves, because we can only understand things through media. It gets to the point, it's like, who is authoring our lives? And then our struggle becomes that between us versus the author of our lives. So that's kind of like a break. That's like basically, I guess, like a 101 course right there in about 5-10 minutes about what postmodernism is. And the issue is, again, like we are living through that. Like you don't choose to be like you. I mean, I know I call myself a postmodernist, but like you don't like choose to live in a postmodern reality that has been foisted upon you. That is the situation you're dealing with. Again, like the whole hyper reality thing is the best way of understanding this. The example I always like going to, the recent example, is where you have Antifa being sad that KKK members didn't show up in the white clan, in the white hoods and robes, because like to them, like that's what the KKK is. It's this media concoction and creation. It's this avatar of pure white, pure evil, and they want that there to be able to simulate that experience, that thrill you get from punching one of them out.